My dear friends watching us tonight, good evening from Mwanza on the shores of Lake Victoria. I'd like to greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In the past 1 week, we've been receiving encouraging reports from various downlink sites around Africa, and we are very grateful for those reports. We are delighted that God is drawing thousands to himself every day, as is evidenced by the thousands who've come to worship with us this evening. Glory to his name. We believe the same is true in other continents where this telecast is being watched. God is good all the time. We would once again like to recognize the participation of our friends in the various downlink sites around the world. In Malawi, I would like to call upon the churches of Soche, Area 23, and Chasefu. In Zambia, the churches of Kansenshi, Chilenye, Woodland. In Uganda, the Adventist Center. In Zimbabwe, Hanke High School, Lower Gweru High School. In Rwanda, Kamembe, Changugu. In Botswana, Mahalape, Francistown. Greetings from Pastor T. Burundi, Jabe, Sororezo, Gitega. In Ghana, Nigeria, Madagascar, Reunion, Cameroon, Mauritius, Angola, Lesotho, Swaziland, the churches of Mbabane and Manzini. In South Africa, we are delighted that brothers and sisters in Lenasia, Natalemdolo, Jabavu, Langa, Kayelisha, Heidelberg. In Kenya, we have some good news. In Kenya, we are glad you're with us tonight. We have some good news from Mozambique always. Keep up the good work there. In Namibia, the congregations at Ingweze, Rundu. Not forgetting Ethiopia, Burundi, Romania, India. The universities of Baraton and Solusi. We would like to recognize the hardships also faced by some of the congregations. Or there would be downlink sites. I have in mind brothers again and sisters in war-torn areas, famine-stricken areas, the refugees, the site with equipment but with no signal. We are praying for you. Let us all work while it is still today. The end is not far, and he who is coming will come. We would like to welcome aboard two sites tonight from the Northeast Tanzania Conference, Mto wa Mbu and Lukovi. Kabuku too, God bless you, and keep up inviting the people to come to these meetings. It's my privilege once again this evening to bring to you my brother and fellow servant in the vineyard of the Lord, Mr. Mbuta Milando, who will lead us to God's throne room of grace as we stand in prayer.
May I ask each one of you, wherever you may be, to stand on your feet to the extent it is possible for you to do so. Also, those who are at our downlink stations, to stand in prayer to our God in heaven. Our dear Father, as you look down upon this huge museum, your children, your sons and daughters are anxious to hear your word. Now, throughout Africa, souls wish to come to you. It is now your work, Father, to give them the word. You have commissioned Pastor Jere Patzer to give your word to all of them. May I ask that you kindly anoint him today in a very special way, because he has a burden on his heart to deliver the message to each one of us here. The message is simple, but our hearts are very hard, like stones. Kindly pour your Holy Spirit on us, on all of us, throughout Africa, at all our downlink stations, all these people who have gathered there, not to resist your call, your call to repent, your call to come to God, your call for all of us to come to our senses. because the end of the world is very near. Jesus will soon burst into the sky, and he will show up here, and he will summon those who are ready to join him, indeed, physically and spiritually, in heaven. Now, we would like everybody to come, with Jesus. You did not create these people to remain here, to be burnt in hell. You created these people to be with you. You gave your son the name Emmanuel, which is God with us. And now, in a very, very special way, Father, I would like to ask that you give us the ability to reach all of them, all people, all souls, through other countries, in Africa, in Europe, in Asia, in America. They should hear your word. I believe this method that we are using is extremely good. You've made it possible for us to speak to each one of us as Seventh-day Adventists and our guests. We would like you now to make it possible for us to speak throughout our divisions by radio and also by television. It is impossible to thank you at this moment because I know you've accepted our request. We will do and we will go to the extent that you want us to go. We pray in Jesus' name. Each one of you should say, Amen. Amen.
Oh. chalo chino mububi la masaka mano ya chalo bulale lale kunwano kwangala
subakwisa tukemba
hosaina No musumino Yesu araisa
Yesu bakwisalo kemba
Hosaina
Kamulumba nebose
Hosaina
Uchitine
abafana batuntulu bose Bakembo rimbo Ati Hosaina
Kati
Alimfu mutwale mwengadilo
Kisa
eloyai
Mwana dambidi
Kwisa tusenda Hosaina
Kati
emfo mutwale mwengadilo
Kwisa
eloyai
Mwana dambidi
Kwisa tusenda Hosaina
distant shore. I'll sing while entering heaven's door. Jesus led me all the way. Jesus led me all the way. Me step by step each day. I will tell the saints and angels as I lay my burdens down. Jesus led me all the way.
we blessed with incredible music here
Amen.
In Mwanza.
Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Ortiz and Mr. Phil. We sure have been enjoying them. And wasn't the choir and the quartet amazing? We have just been so blessed. We went into some churches on Sabbath, and I was overwhelmed, Darren, by we sat in the churches, and not only could the whole church carry a tune, but they could carry a tune in four-part harmony.
Amen, amen.
It was incredible. I was really blessed.
We have been. We want to remember tonight specifically, we have such an opportunity here as brothers and sisters to worship God, to worship Jesus, and that is why we are here tonight. Throughout the world, we have brothers and sisters who cannot meet the same way that we can. And we want to encourage you at the satellite sites or here at the stadium, during your private time with Jesus at night or in the mornings, to remember those people in prayer. Remember people like Brother Atikov, who is spending each and every day in a prison in a country where he does not have the religious freedom that we do here tonight. Satellite churches, we wish to remind you that we have a fax and an email account where you can send us stories of miracles and various other things that are happening at your downlink site. Tonight, we have a very special feature for you. To introduce that, I would like to have you picture yourself as the pastor of a large church, a successful church, a church you have worked at for many, many years, over 10 years, and you have finally, after all your work, become comfortable. But you know what? The Lord calls to you one night and says, "Brother, I need you to go on a mission for me." Much like Jonah, you say, "Lord, I'm comfortable. I'm working hard for you. Each week I preach hard for you." But he says, "I want you to go and do more." Tonight we have a special video feature about a gentleman named Greg Nelson, brother of Dwight Nelson, who was featured in our Net 98 broadcast, satellite event that some of you may have seen. Greg Nelson has moved to Seattle, Washington, and is meeting with homeless people, is meeting with people from various businesses and young adults and older adults trying to start up a church in that vast city.
Yes, and the second player in that neat team, Darren, is also someone that you may remember from the Net 98 meetings, that another satellite evangelism event similar to this. Shasta Burr is a familiar name. She is just a beautiful person both inside and outside, and a friend of ours. And she is another player there with Greg Nelson, also with her husband Jere, and they are in the heart of Seattle ministering to the people downtown Seattle. Now, as we think about the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we have a global outreach. We're doing an incredible thing here in Mwanza. This is such a neat event. Mm-hmm. And as we think about the leadership of Tanzania and how it's reaching out to the large cities here, we also want to emphasize the incredible sacrifice of people in ministry around the world. For instance, right here in Africa, in our very own stadium here for the local audience, we have the people from Kibidula Publishing over here. They have tons of
books
and tracts, yeah. Mm-hmm. And they're working
with the people in the heart of Africa. We want to really lift up the people tonight who work in ministries that aren't recognized, like the satellite broadcast. This is an incredible event, but we have people that are working around the world. Please pray for those people who are working in areas where they are not recognized for Christ. And right now, we'd like to introduce that video that we've just been talking about with Greg Nelson and Shasta Burr.
This is the hardest thing I've had to do in the 25 years of pastoring, to completely change pastoral paradigms and leave something that's established and known, something I'm familiar with, to come to the unknown of downtown Seattle to raise up a church here for the thousands of young professionals, many of whom don't know Jesus.
What the church needs today is people who will look at their own backyard, their own neighborhood, their own workplaces as the ultimate mission field to lead people to Jesus. All my years as a pastor, I've told the people, "Folks, let's get out there and let's share the light of Jesus with the people who don't know Jesus." But now he said, "I want you to go outside the stadium. I want you to go into a place of darkness and be that point of light."
This is Pike's Place Market. We love it here because it's symbolic of the amazing diversity that exists in downtown Seattle. Right now, we're a church without walls. So this is our church. And Shasta and I are trying to meet as many people as we can to build those relationships.
We do that in the elevator, we do that in our buildings, we do that out on the streets, we're doing it at the coffee shops we attend, the crepe places, anywhere and everywhere.
We're trying to start a church in this downtown area. What's your name?
Harold McKenna.
Harold?
Yeah.
Greg Nelson.
All right.
Nice to meet you. Harold, what's the last name?
Metcalf.
Metcalf, we're watching for it, man.
If you never walk around,
I know.
You never see them.
What I've discovered is that is a God thing. There are no chance encounters. I mean, you meet someone like this, God puts them in, man.
There is so much ministry that happens because we are living right here in the heart of this city. We can't imagine trying to reach the people in this community without living right in the middle of them.
Having grown up in a Christian culture my entire life, one of the most overwhelming parts of living in downtown Seattle for me is living among people who don't even believe in God. To have Buddhists sitting at my dining room table, or to have somebody tell me they've never even stepped foot inside of a Christian church, is so foreign to me. It's one of those things where we're just forced to rely on God every single day.
Now, there's certainly lots of challenges, but Jesus wanted to live among the people in order to reach them more effectively, and we've decided that that's something that's important for us too, and we're finding that this now is becoming our home.
I look out over the city from the Space Needle down to Safeco Field, from five levels underground all the way up to the sky, and I just can't help think, wow, this is our parish.
I want you to take your flashlight, go into the darkness, and be that point of light for me. Man, what a challenge.
We want to give a hand at the theme song, I Found a Way in Jesus. Phil, we'll do it a cappella with the accompaniment of Phil, and then the bell cobras will come in. I found a way, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way, Jesus. He is my way to heaven. I found a way, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way, Jesus. He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now. Nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now. To me, Yona, Gia, Gia, Gia. To me, Yona, Gia, Gia, Yahuzima. To me, Yona, Gia, Gia, Gia. To me, Yona, Gia, Gia, Yahuzima. Hata Shetani Apinge, Hata Shetani Apinge, Hata Shetani Apinge, Yesu Hata Ubiri.
Good evening, my friends, wherever you are around the world tonight. I hope you got some of the excitement of that just incredible musical festival tonight. I was so blessed. I hope it comes through on satellite, because it was certainly wonderful here. Thank you, everyone. And then that feature on the big screen back where, near where we live, our family, back in the United States, that brought home some good memories of some of our special friends. And each evening, it just gets better and better. God just keeps blessing. And we're glad to be back here tonight on a beautiful star and moonlit night. Praise God for that. Yes? Amen. Amen. Well, we're here. The stories are coming in. You're sending them via fax and via email. Incredible stories of what God is doing to the hundreds of thousands of people that are hearing these messages. We just praise his name. Tomorrow night, you're going to hear one that's just beyond the imagination, and I want you to make sure you're here, because that story in and of itself will be worth hearing. But it's another demonstration that God is working in a world that so often appears not to even care that he exists. Well, we have seven sites there in Uganda. Muli Mutia, they say. How are you? We want to welcome all of you there in Uganda. Tonight, an incredibly important sequel to what we talked about last night. The title is An Old Wives' Tale. You recall what we talked about last night. It was new to many of you. Tonight, we're going to look at the other side of that. We're going to do the flip side. To be fair, we want to look at what the Bible also says about Sunday, whether or not we should observe that day holy. Now, a man once said, Pastor, don't forget that the Bible says God helps those who help themselves. But do you know something, friends? That helpful little verse that translates into most of the languages that you're hearing this in tonight doesn't even come from the Bible. It's a saying taken from an old book, Poor Richard's Almanac, published by Benjamin Franklin, who was in fact one of the founding fathers of the United States of America. Yet many people think that it came from the Bible. Have you ever had someone quote you this Bible proverb? And I know some of you have this in your languages. This is what it says. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Well, it's a quaint and guiding statement, but it doesn't come from the Proverbs or anywhere else in this Bible for that matter. It's what we refer to in the United States in English as an old wives' tale or an old legend. Now, has anyone ever told you that the Bible says to err is human, but to forgive is divine? The Bible doesn't say that either. What about this one? Some of you have this in your cultures. What about a full belly makes a dull brain? Or this very familiar one that I know many of you have in your language. Early to bed and early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise. Remember these? Or this one, the rotten apple spoils his companion. Or as Natalie said to me just today, not knowing I was going to mention it tonight, eat to live rather than living to eat. These are sayings that we have heard for such a long time that we are sometimes confused, or we get confused over, into thinking that they have a basis right in our own Bibles. Well, tonight I want us to look at something else with much more significant than any of these old wives' tales that people wholeheartedly believe come from the Bible, but really don't. In fact, there are some people who would almost stake their lives on the beliefs that we are going to discuss tonight. Now, we can't possibly be experts on everything under the sun. So many of our beliefs, admittedly, tend to be inherited by believing what our parents or our trusted friends tell us. And therefore, we sometimes become a little confused. We forget where the basis of some of our beliefs originally came from. Now, even in Christ's day, there was a problem of confusing Scripture with tradition. Jesus talked about it in Matthew, the 15th chapter, verses 3 and 9. This is what he said. And he answered and said to them, "Why do you also transgress the commandment of God because of your tradition?" Now keep that text in the back of your mind, because we're going to be referring to it again. The basis of people's belief had become so confused to the point that in some cases they couldn't differentiate between that which was tradition and from that which was from the Bible. And Jesus said, "And in vain they do worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men." You see, God said that you and I need to read the Bible for ourselves, as we've emphasized over and over during these meetings, rather than believe what our parents or even our friends or even our pastors tell us is truth, at the risk of potentially dangerous practices that may involve adopting old wives' tales into our understanding of God's will for us. Now, I want to know what real Bible truth is. Don't you? That's what we said every night. John 8:32 promises that those who diligently seek it will find it. This is what the Bible says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Truth gives freedom. Now, where can we find truth? Gateway Rwanda? Where can we find truth? In John 14:6, it says, "Jesus said to him, 'I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.'" So, I can find truth then in the life of Jesus. John 17:17 tells us that there's another place that we can find truth, and it's God's Word. "Sanctify them by your truth," the Bible says. "Your Word is truth." You see, this book, the Bible, is truth. And it's not some form of relative truth, friends. It is absolute truth, God's truth. Psalm 119, 142 tells us another place, a third place, that we can find truth. This is what it says: "Your righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and your law is truth." Now, I can find truth in God's law. So I look at the life of Jesus, I read God's word, and compare it with God's law, and I will know what is truth. And it's so important to God that we learn his truth, that he promised to send help to those who search. In John 16:13, he said, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. So you see, by asking for guidance from the Holy Spirit, as I study the life of Christ and compare it with God's word and his law, I will arrive at truth. Now, last night, we spent an evening studying many of the Bible texts which lead us to conclude unequivocally that Saturday is the day God chose at creation to rest and hallow as the Sabbath, his day of worship. Let's review just rather quickly tonight some of those points about the seventh day Sabbath. Number one, God created the Sabbath. Genesis 2:1, we found it. Secondly, God rested, verses 1 to 3. Thirdly, God sanctified or made holy the Sabbath, Exodus 20:12. Then we went on. The Sabbath is a sign between God and his people that he will sanctify his people, there in Ezekiel 20:12. And we went on. We found that the Sabbath was kept after Christ's death. You see, Christ kept the Sabbath, we know that. But after his death, there was the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD. But Christ predicted that nearly 40 years after his death that it would happen in Matthew 24:20. And he said, pray that your flight will not be on the Sabbath day. He expected that his followers would still be keeping the Sabbath 40 years after his death. And then we looked at some of the apostles, like Paul, there in Acts 18:4. And we found that clearly, Paul and his colleagues were meeting with the Jews and the Greeks and the Gentiles on the Sabbath day. And then we found in Isaiah 66:23 that we will keep Sabbath, God's people will keep Sabbath, even in heaven. And finally, we learned that the Sabbath is the seventh day, unequivocally. They were never mixed up. The Sabbath didn't somehow slip into sixth place in the calendar week. And we learned that God commanded us to keep it in Exodus 20:8-11. And he went on and he said, if you love me, keep my commandments, John 14:15. And so we saw in that study last night, as we looked through verse after verse after verse, it is very clear that right from the Garden of Eden, way before there ever was a Jew, on through the Ten Commandments, on through the Old Testament, through the life of Christ, on through the apostles, and then, as we just quoted, on into the new earth, God's people have, are, and will keep the seventh day holy. Now, I know that you and I must be intelligent as we search for truth, that we don't limit ourselves to a conclusion based on a partial examination, an examination of only one side of this significant issue. You see, there are people who believe with all their hearts that there are places in God's word where God blessed and hallowed and sanctified the first day of the week. We need to be objective and to see what God's word says that might support the other side of this argument. After all, I really don't care who wins the argument. Do you? All I care about is knowing the truth that God intended for me to have. And I have no interest in standing up here on this platform for something that is not the truth. Regardless of how much I might respect or love my friends and my relatives who might believe that it is truth. You know what we say, those of you in Lagos, West Nigeria, if it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it's not in the Bible, then it's not for me. So tonight, we are going to examine precisely what the Scripture says about every single text in the Bible that mentions the first day of the week. Now, don't get worried. We're not going to be here all night. There aren't that many texts that refer to the first day of the week or Sunday. But in the next few minutes, we're going to open our Bibles and we're going to look at every single verse that references Sunday or the first day of the week to see what God says about it. Because we want an answer for this question. Does the Scripture anywhere say that God blessed and hallowed and sanctified the first day of the week? That's what our whole presentation tonight is about. Does God sanctify anywhere in the Bible the first day of the week? Now, let's get started. The first mention of the first day of the week in the Bible is naturally back in the Old Testament in conjunction with creation. Genesis 1:5 says this: God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. This text simply says that on the first day, God created the light and the dark. It says nothing about God blessing, hallowing, or sanctifying the first day. In fact, any day of the week could have been the Sabbath, except for the first day of the week. Follow me closely on this logic. You see, it was not impossible for God to have created the world in 5 days and rested on the sixth. It certainly would not have been impossible for our great God to have created the world in 4 days and rested on the fifth. And now, since he is an all-powerful God, he could have created the world in 3 days and then rested on the fourth. Being that he spoke the world into existence, which we believe he did, he could have created the world in just 2 days and then rested on the third. In reality, it would not have been beyond omnipotence for him to have created the world in 1 day and rested on the second day. But one thing God could not do is to work at creating the world within the first day and rested all day the first day. You can't have it both ways. According to this text, in the creation story, the only day that could not have been God's day of rest was the first day. You see, the truth we have discovered from this text is that God created light and darkness on that first day of creation. And there's something else that's very significant that we can learn from this first text as well. When does it say that the day as God created it begins and ends? The Bible says that the evening and the morning were the first day. In other words, according to Scripture, as you saw that beautiful picture of right here in Mwanza, the Scripture day begins at one sunset and ends at the next sunset. And that's why those who keep the seventh-day Sabbath keep it from Friday sundown to Saturday sundown, from evening to evening. The evening and the morning, it says, were the first day. This becomes important as we look at more Scripture. Now let's do it. I have just shared with you, friends, you may be surprised, I have just shared with you all, every single one of the texts in the Old Testament that even mentions the first day of the week. There's only one. Are you surprised? So now we have to go on, because I promised you we'd look at all of them. So we move on to the New Testament. We'll go first to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 1. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. This verse is telling us that the Sabbath was over. The first day of the week was dawning, and these two ladies were going to the tomb of Jesus. Well, there's nothing here that says God blessed, hallowed, or sanctified the first day of the week in this verse. Now, had there been a change in the Sabbath, Matthew would have certainly said something about it, because the Gospel of Matthew was not written until 60 AD, 29 years after the death of Jesus. He would have certainly recorded such a significant change had he been aware of one. But that's the only verse mentioning the first day of the week in the entire book of Matthew. So let's go to the writings of Mark and see what he says. We find it, Mark 16, verses 1 and 2. Now when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices that they might come and anoint him very early in the morning on the first day of the week. Came to the tomb when the sun had risen. Here Mark says pretty much the same thing that Matthew says, that Mary, the other women, came to the tomb at dawn on the first day of the week. Now, why did they come to the tomb? Akuri, Nigeria? To anoint or embalm Jesus? That's right. They did not go to the tomb to worship. They went, as a matter of fact, to work. And again, as in Matthew, the text says that the day of worship had just passed. You see, they came early in the morning because Christ had been dead for 36 hours already. And rigor mortis, decaying, would have begun, and the embalming needed to be done quickly. So they came early, while it would still be cool, before the sun began its scorching work. This embalming process was hard work. It took 130 pounds of spices, or 40 kilos, to embalm a body. 100 pounds, or 30 kilos, of which the Bible says had already been brought by Nicodemus. John, the 19th chapter, the 39th verse. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. So there is nothing in this text significant to worshiping on the first day of the week either. Now there's one more text in Mark that mentions the first day. It's in chapter 16, verse 9. Now when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 demons. The Bible says here that Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, and he appeared to Mary Magdalene before anyone else saw him. Now remember, we are examining one text after another that mentions the first day of the week, in order that their appearance in the Scriptures for indications that God blessed or hallowed or sanctified it. But there's nothing in Mark. So let's go on to the Gospel of Luke. Luke, the 24th chapter, verses 1 to 3. This is what it says. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, They and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing spices which they had prepared. Luke is saying the same thing that Matthew and Mark have said before, that the women came early in the morning bringing the spices they had prepared. You see, now Luke was, by profession, a physician. And because he tends to pay closer attention to details than the other gospel writers, and you can find that in most of his writings, we see just a little different perspective. So let's back up about five verses and let Luke supply the details of this story for us. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. You see, Luke is talking about Joseph of Arimathea, a wealthy Jewish ruler that he mentioned in the previous verse. And it goes on, then he took it down, speaking of the body of Jesus, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock where no one had ever before been laid. Now, I've personally had the privilege, as some of you have, of being at a tomb outside of Jerusalem. Some people think that that's actually the exact tomb where Jesus was buried. There are several rock ledges for the placement of bodies in tombs like this. And it was customary back then for more than one deceased person to be placed in the same tomb. In fact, there are places in some parts of the world that you're familiar with where tombs are only rented. And if the family does not pay the rent, the remains are removed from the tomb. And Luke is simply saying that this tomb was a brand new one that Joseph of Arimathea had made for himself. So that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near. The preparation day is the day we know as what? Good Friday. The Bible clearly says it was the day that Christ died. Luke 23, 55, 56 goes on. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after. And they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils. And they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. So Luke tells us without question that these women prepared their burial spices. Then, interestingly enough, they kept the Sabbath as usual, even though they had this important work. Some people ask, is the Sabbath important? Let me ask you something. If these women would not even anoint the body of Jesus to prepare it for burial on the Sabbath, then who am I to say the Sabbath is not important? You see, there are many things, even humanitarian deeds or family activities, that may be very good in and of themselves, but are not appropriate when we fully appreciate the high and the holy concept of a sanctified day of rest with God. So Luke continues. In chapter 24, verse 1, now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found, praise God, the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in, and they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Praise God. Luke said that the stone, that giant stone that had been sealed with the emperor's stamp, had been rolled away, and that Jesus Christ had risen from the tomb. There is nothing here at all to say that the first day of the week received any kind of blessing from God. This is the only verse in Luke that talks about the first day of the week. And so we move on to John the 20th chapter, the first verse. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early. This sounds pretty familiar now. While it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. You see, John says that when Mary arrived at the tomb, Jesus had already risen, and it was still the dark part of the first day of the week. As we learned earlier from the creation story, a biblical day is 24 hours from sundown to sundown, and it's divided into two parts, the light and the dark part. The dark part comes first and extends from when the sun goes down, like it did a little bit ago, until it comes up the following morning. And then the light part is the second half of the biblical day, extending from sun up until the sun goes down and begins the next day. According to the biblical day, when did Sunday begin? It began at sundown Saturday night. And according to that knowledge and this text that we just read, when did Christ arise? He arose sometime between sundown Saturday night and dawn on Sunday morning, which biblically is called the dark part of Sunday. And again, John mentions nothing, absolutely, about a change or a special blessing being placed on the first day of the week. Now, there's one more first day text in John. It's in verse 19 of the same chapter. This is what it says. Then the same day, at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." Now, friends, here is an old wives' tale. There are some people who say that that text proves that the disciples began worshiping on Sunday morning. But look at it carefully. Does it say that they were worshiping? No, it doesn't. Why were they meeting? They were hiding because they were afraid of the Jews and that they would be arrested and then maybe crucified just as Jesus had been. And there they were hiding out, and suddenly Jesus appears among them and says to them, "Peace be with you." Nothing speaks here of worship or a change in the first day of the week. So, friends, we have read what Matthew, what Mark, what Luke, and what John say about the first day of the week. And you may be surprised, but there are only two more verses in the entire Bible that mention the first day of the week. Now listen carefully, because most of all the reasons people give for worshiping on the first day of the week stem from these next two verses. Let's look at them carefully. The first of the two remaining texts is found in the book of Acts, chapter 20, verses 7 to 12. Let's read the whole thing. Now on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where they were gathered together. Now you see, this meeting is taking place on the first day of the week. And the text says that they are meeting for what purpose? They are meeting to break bread. They are meeting to eat. Now Paul was supposed to leave the very next day. So this meeting is taking place during what time of the day? It has to be an evening meeting because Paul preached, it says, until midnight. and there were many lamps in the room. Now something very interesting takes place. And in a window, the Bible says, sat a certain young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep. He was overcome by sleep, the Bible says, and as Paul continued speaking, he fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. Now, that's a sad story up to this point. But there are two good lessons to be learned from the story at this point. One of those lessons is for me. Okay? I better keep my sermons rather short. And there's one lesson for you. You better not go to sleep while I'm preaching. You see, Eutychus fell asleep while Paul was talking, and he fell out of the window, and dramatically, he was killed. The Bible goes on with the story. But Paul went down, he fell on him, embraced him, and said, "Do not trouble yourselves, for his life is in him." And Paul prayed for the boy. God gave him his life back. And now when he comes up, he had broken bread and eaten and talked a long while, even till daybreak, he departed. And they brought the young man, the Bible says, in alive, and they were not just a little comforted. Now Paul and his friends spent all night there at that place. And Paul preached, and a boy falls out of the window. God restores him to life. They ate a meal and they talked until daybreak here in the city of Troas. Meanwhile, Paul's fellow missionaries, Luke, Timothy, Silas, have boarded a ship sailing to Azos, where Paul intended to meet them. In their words, they said, "Then we went ahead by ship and sailed to Azos, there intending to take Paul on board. For so he had given orders, intending himself to go on foot." Now this was Paul's third missionary journey to Troas. It's about 12 kilometers from Azos. And Paul planned to walk on Sunday morning over to Azos, where he would meet the ship and his companions. Now why did Paul spend the entire night socializing with his friends in Troas? Why was he so reluctant to leave them? All of you that are watching from the 15 sites there in Bulawayo? You see, it was Paul who had started this church, and these people loved him. He intended to go back to Jerusalem for the Feast of Unleavened Bread, where he knew he would have an excellent opportunity to preach to the Jews who did not yet know Jesus. And an angel had told him that when he arrived in Jerusalem, he would be bound, chained, and transported to Rome. So Paul and his friends knew that it was very likely they would never see one another again. The church members have a farewell meeting for Paul that lasts all night long. Then can you imagine having to walk 12 kilometers, about 8 miles, after a night of no sleep? Let's pinpoint the timing of this meeting, shall we? When does the biblical day begin? Right there in Yaoundé in Cameroon? When does it begin? It begins, according to the Bible, at sunset. Acts 20 says that this meeting was on the first day of the week. That's the reason we stopped here in the first place, because we're examining those first day of the week texts, remember? The first day of the week begins at sunset on Saturday and ends on sunset the next day. That's the way God created it when he said the evening and the morning were the first day. So Paul and his friends had a meeting on Saturday night that lasted all night. Then on Sunday morning, he walked those 12 kilometers to Azos. This is how the New English Bible translation correctly translates Acts 20, verse 7. On the Saturday night, in our assembly for the breaking of bread. See? That's what we're saying. Again, however, nowhere in this entire story does it say that God sanctified or that he blessed the first day of the week. Now, 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2 is the only other remaining scripture that mentions the first day of the week. And here Paul again has written to the churches in Corinth, as he has other churches, telling them that there is a famine in Jerusalem, asking them to collect donations to help the people there. And these are his instructions. Listen. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so that you must do also, on the first day of the week, let each one of you lay aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there be no collections when I come. This does not say that they were to take their offerings to church on Sunday, as that old wives' tale goes on. He instructed them to lay their gifts aside, meaning at a home or wherever, so that there would be no collections when he came. The problem was that in Paul's day, very few people had money like we carry around. Most people traded using the barter system. If you had some corn in a crop that you needed some tomatoes for, you would take a bushel of your corn to the market and trade it for the corresponding values worth of tomatoes. The barter system is still a reliable and active part of commerce in many places today, like you saw in that picture a moment ago. And so the early church continues to observe the seventh-day Sabbath and was equally as social as it was spiritual. Now, undoubtedly, Paul's letter was read in church on Sabbath. Following me, those of you in Battle Creek and Delton, Michigan, back in the United States where we come from, he was essentially saying this to the Corinthian church members. Travel arrangements are haphazard. My schedule is uncertain. If you want to help the people in Jerusalem by donating a bushel of wheat or some blankets or some oil, decide what you want to give. Then on Sunday, the first day of the week, that would have been their first opportunity for them, after they had observed the Sabbath, set aside what you'll give so that when I arrive, you will not have to spend time running around collecting all those donations. And so once again, there is nothing in this text that even mentions the first day of the week as being set aside for any holy purpose. Now friends, do you see how easy we can build our faith and beliefs on God's holy word when we read the Bible for ourselves and ardently avoid believing those old wives' tales? Now, last night we studied many texts that clearly tell us Jesus created, proclaimed, and kept the seventh day as the holy Sabbath. There were more that we simply did not have time to read, and they all support the same conclusion. We have just finished examining every single possible text that exists from the beginning to the end of the Bible, from which we might conclude that God intended for us to worship on the first day of the week. And we have found absolutely nothing that even remotely indicates a change in Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. And after a thorough investigation from God's Word, the weight of Bible evidence is unanimously in favor of the seventh day Sabbath. I want to read to you a couple of very impressive statements by some well-known theologians from a different church denomination. Listen, the first one is from Cardinal Gibbon of the Catholic Church. Now, folks, I want to quickly say that there are many, many, many good, sincere, Catholic people in that church today. I'm merely quoting from one of their leaders who wrote, "You may read the Bible," said the cardinal, "from Genesis to Revelation, and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of Sunday." He went on, "The scripture enforces the religious observance of Saturday, a day which we never sanctify." That was in the faith of our fathers. You see, the Catholic Church knows that the Bible does not in any place authorize the sanctification of Sunday to make it holy. Do you remember reading from history about the Protestant Reformation? Sure you did. Men like Luther, Knox, Newton, Wesley, these great reformers, because the Reformation shook the church to its very foundation, a tremendous effort was made to restore the church to solid biblical ground. During the Council of Trent, which lasted 17 years, a group of bishops and archbishops, cardinals and priests, decided that if they were going to get their church, the Catholic Church, back on solid biblical ground, it would have to comply again to the Word of God and the Word of God alone. Unfortunately, another group disagreed, saying that if the church were to again stand on solid foundation, it must rely on both Scripture and church tradition. And that argument was discussed and debated for the entire 17 years, until at the end, the Archbishop of Reggio addressed the entire council with these historic words, and they're recorded. "The authority of the church could therefore not be bound by the authority of the scriptures." Wow. Because the church had changed the Sabbath into Sunday. And he goes on, "Not by the command of Christ, but by its own authority." Friends, this was the Catholic Archbishop who was admitting that if the Catholic Church were to take a stand on Scripture alone, they would have to return to keeping the Bible Sabbath. And if they were to continue worshiping on the first day of the week, Sunday, then church doctrine would have to stand on both Scripture and tradition, based upon that presupposition. Unfortunately, the Council of Trent voted that Scripture and tradition are equal streams of truth. And furthermore, they stated that if there exists a contradiction between Scripture and the tradition of the church, they would rely first on tradition in preference to Scripture. But remember what the Bible says. We read it earlier in Matthew 15:3, friends. "Why do you also transgress the commandment of God? Because of your tradition." Now, I don't know about you, but as far as I am concerned, I am compelled to take my stand on God's holy word. God has a special group of people right down in the last days that he speaks about in Revelation 14:12, where he says, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus." You see, friends, this group of people is special because they are keeping the commandments of God. You may say, "But there aren't really that many people who actually keep the Sabbath." Oh, that's true. Even if you don't count all the Jewish people, millions of Jewish people, there are still millions of Sabbath-keeping Christians. And the facts are that down through history, the majority, when it comes to spiritual matters, has often been wrong. But tonight, I would like to acquaint you with some very respected people who have faithfully kept God's holy seventh-day Sabbath. You see, my Bible tells me that Abraham kept the Sabbath, that Moses kept the Sabbath, that Elijah kept the Sabbath, that David and Daniel and Mary Magdalene and Peter and Paul kept the Bible Sabbath. And my Bible tells me, dear friends, that standing head and shoulders above them all is the example of Jesus Christ, who also kept his Sabbath. I don't know about you, my friend, but I have to take my stand with that minority any day. What about you? This great Coliseum tonight, those of you that are watching in hundreds and hundreds of Down Lake sites tonight, where do you want to stand? On tradition or with the minority on God's word? Listen, think clearly, pray about it while my friend Walter sings this appeal song.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood.
Tonight, friends,
to thee,
you've heard it as clearly as the Holy Spirit can convict you. This was not the words of Dr. Jere Patzer. This was the words straight from the Bible. Last night we talked about all those texts that command us, command God's people to be faithful in keeping the seventh day Sabbath. Tonight we looked at the other side. All of those texts, every single one, there was about 10 or 12 of them, that even remotely refer to the first day of the week. And you have to be honest and admit not one of those can in any way be construed to command you to keep the first day of the week holy. Tonight, I just want you to be honest. I want you to be honest with yourself. But more importantly, I want you to be honest with God. Because as we've said over and over, if it's in the Bible, it's for me. If it's not in the Bible, then it's not for me. We found that it's not in the Bible to keep the first day of the week holy. Tonight, I'm going to make an appeal. First, a very general appeal, and then a more specific one. Of all the people that are here tonight in this stadium, and all the people that are in these hundreds of downlink sites around the world that have experienced the blessing of keeping the seventh day holy, if you have been blessed by keeping the Sabbath day holy, I want you to stand to your feet right now. Stand to your feet. If you believe that the seventh day is God's holy, sanctified day. But there's another group that's here tonight, and that it's all these downlink sites as well. That you heard some new things tonight that may have shaken you. You may have gone home last night saying, wow, I can't believe that. That's different than anything I've ever learned. And if that's the case, I want to appeal to you especially tonight. Around you are people who can testify that God will bless you for keeping His holy day. But I want to challenge you tonight to make a stand for that day and for God too. As Walter Ortiz sings the last verse of this song, I want you to come forward tonight. Oh, I know. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of you made a decision, and you were baptized this past weekend. We saw some of those on the screen, but as the reports have come in, that number has grown and grown and grown. Over thousands that were baptized this past weekend. We'll have more reports. But there are some of you that were not. And you're learning this new dynamic of the Bible. And I want to appeal to you tonight, wherever you are in this large stadium, to come right down here to the front. And if you're seated in or standing in one of those downlink sites, those satellite downlink sites, there is someone at the front of that auditorium waiting for you to come. Dear friend, come right now. Come right now. There are leaders that are going to join me here. If you have heard this message and you want to say, yes, I want to stand with those who have made the decision down through the ages to be faithful to God, then come tonight. Come to Him just as you are. Accept the Sabbath as God's holy day, sanctified by God Himself. And He will bless you for the decision of your life. Friends, while he sings, come forward. This is not a general call. This is for ones who were not baptized this weekend. This is for individuals who said, tonight I have learned new truth, truth that I have not made a decision on before. Bless your hearts. Young people, older people, men, women, you see them coming. Come, friends. If you have not before made a decision about God's holy day, and tonight you learned that there is a day that He wants His people to keep, come forward right now, and we will have a prayer of dedication and commitment for you. Don't hesitate. Don't linger. Come down, as thousands and millions have done before. Come and make that decision for the first time to keep the Sabbath holy. In about 2 minutes, we're going to go off of live satellite. I want those of you out there in satellite land to take very seriously these last few moments of this call. People are coming, many are coming, that are making a first-time commitment to the seventh-day Sabbath here in this great auditorium. And that's on top of all of those that were baptized this past weekend and have made decisions. But those of you out there, if you're in your seat, or even if you're standing, I want to encourage you right now, go forward, join all of these here and all of those down through history that have made a commitment to follow God's commandments over and above the tradition of men. Tonight, without a shadow of a doubt, we have proved that the Bible Sabbath is a seventh-day Sabbath. There's no discussion really on that point. The only decision left is whether or not you will respond to God's holy day. Those of you at the downlink sites, I encourage you to be with us tomorrow night. We're going to talk about divine healing, and it will be assured. Be back here at the same place. But right now, in the last 30 seconds of this appeal, before we go off, won't you come forward? Accept God. Accept His holy day. And you can make a statement for eternity. I want to thank you for being with us tonight and hearing this powerful message. God has blessed us.